you know, the infrastructure piece, people think about infrastructure as the stuff that's there. And then we kind of learn in Katrina and Sandy that when it's not there, it's a problem. But I think even more importantly, if you look at what we've done around terrorism and learning about terrorism in the last decade, since 9/11, the central message is that there are a whole set of critical infrastructures. And while we've been busy learning and about how to think about vulnerabilities of those critical infrastructures to terrorism, and we call them critical infrastructures in a national security sense, in that it's not just that our lives are miserable for a couple of months or even a couple of years if that infrastructure is damaged by some kind of an event, but that these infrastructures are fundamental to the security of our communities and the security of our country. And vulnerabilities to those infrastructures are deeply problematic. And so while we've been doing all of that, we've given almost no thought to a parallel set of vulnerabilities to those same critical infrastructures that are equally hidden, equally elusive, and yet equally significant.
Everybody can relate to the hurricane in New Orleans or the storm in New England. And they can't say why it happened, but they see the impacts of what happened. So communities across the country are coming to the conclusion that they need to evaluate their infrastructure, one, to identify to what standards was that infrastructure built, and to what extent can that infrastructure withstand changes in climate or significant weather events. And it's such an open field for public officials. They're surrounded by infrastructure that they own. We're sitting here in the city of Phoenix, and over the weekend we got 1 3/4 inches of rain in 24 hours. That doesn't sound like a lot if you live on the East Coast, but that was the most significant daily rain on that date in January in the history of the state. And there are places in the valley right now that are flooding because the infrastructure wasn't built to manage that kind of water.
What few people realize is the role that infrastructure plays in relationship to climate change in two respects. First of all, climate change is driven by our infrastructure choices. So the kinds of transportation systems we build, the kinds of energy systems that we design and maintain impact climate change because they affect emissions. And at the same time, infrastructure is what mediates the effects of climate change on our lives. And so infrastructure is a kind of a boundary in between our physical and natural world and our human experience. So if climate becomes hotter, we can design infrastructure that keeps us cooler, of course, at a certain price. And I think one of the unique things about this relationship between climate change and infrastructure is that both of them are, in a sense, hidden. Our infrastructure is not displayed openly and discussed. It's often buried and hidden and put in wires above our heads. And likewise, climate change is not something that's easily tangible or easily sensed by people. It's something that we need tools to understand and to predict.
In our organization, I work for a county, and I have 6,900 square miles of geography and almost 500,000 people for whom I feel a deep responsibility to be well prepared. And on any given day, we are now facing wildfires and floods in the same week because of extreme weather events, drought combined with diminished snowpack. And I feel a responsibility and a duty to work with some of the greatest minds, and we're listening to some of them this week, struggling with not only, we're not only trying to overcome the disbelief about this particular issue in science But we're also struggling to engage people in something that has such a long horizon, both to experience on a global level and to fix anything about.
Much of the time, we live our lives unaware of the infrastructure that we have built around us, whether it's roads, whether it's communication, whether it's power. There's so many infrastructures that we just take for granted. They're part of the fabric of our lives. We almost relate to them as though they are part of the natural world. And yet, they are susceptible to all kinds of problems. And we become aware of it when there's some kind of disaster or freaky problem with it. So power outages are a good example. The ice storm in New England that brings down power lines. Maybe it's roads buckling because of extreme heat. Sometimes these things happen because of the natural variation in nature, or just we messed up, right? But sometimes they happen because we're actually hitting new extremes of our climate for which our infrastructure was not designed. And if we recognize that the problems we're experiencing with familiar infrastructure are arising because of some change in the normal limits of climate. Gee, we're experiencing temperatures not here within what we're used to, but out here, we begin to realize, hey, wait a second, the fabric of our lives is actually dependent upon climate. So infrastructure becomes this way of relating climate and climate extremes to our daily lives.
If you look at these systems and you ask, okay, so what if the climate statistics in the future are not what the climate statistics of the past were? Are our system, infrastructure systems set up to deal with those different climate parameters and climate statistics? The answer is no. None of them are.